Ann Compton, welcome to Milwaukee, and congratulations on the Press Club Award.
Thank you. The Sacred Cat Award. I've been called many things, not that before.
It's quite an honor and well-deserved. Let's talk a little bit about changes in the industry today, the news industry. And I wanted to begin by talking about access. Access that the media, the traditional media, has to presidents, to people who want to be president.
Yeah.
How much has it changed during your time?
It has gone downhill. And I covered the White House over an arc of 40 years and within that 10 presidential campaigns. And we used to see the presidential candidates so often. We used to see the president so often. And I feel, especially under the current administration, we're almost 7 years into the Obama administration, we see so little of him face to face. We so rarely can ask the president direct questions on what's going on right now. And part of the reason of that is we're in a new technological age where we have given presidents and the public the tools of journalism. They've got cell phones, so they can capture the news. They are eyewitness to events, and then they can publish them. They can put them on the internet. So President Obama very often doesn't include the press in a photo op or a meeting, but his own weekly newscast on Friday mornings on WhiteHouse.gov, called West Wing Week. Mm-hmm. He does his press secretary anchors a newscast of the news according to Barack Obama.
Is this the wave of the future? I look at...
I certainly hope not.
But you look at people have been critical of Hillary Clinton for taking 13 questions since she announced her candidacy for president. Governor Walker was just in Israel, but there were no media with him. No clue as to who was traveling with him. All you saw was tweets from the Walker campaign about his trip.
That's where we've given the candidates and the president their own means to get straight through, their own unfiltered message. In the old days, you know, the president had to ask for primetime television to get that message across. Ronald Reagan, the great communicator, used it a lot. But now that candidates, presidents, would-be presidents, and certainly their staffs have the ability to get their own storyline out in little unchallengeable bursts, I think it really weakens the good, well-rounded picture Americans should have of their political leaders and holding them accountable. We can't hold them accountable when they can simply tweet at us 140 characters.
Is this just a big deal to people like us? Does the public care whether or not we had the kind of access we once had?
I don't think there's a lot of sympathy, especially for the White House press corps out in the middle America. But I do think Americans care that political leaders be held accountable and be held to defend and explain why they're doing what they're doing. And why I think people should care over the next 18 months, 24 months, we have the first election coming along that I can recall where it's coming on the heels of two-term presidents. We've had three presidents over an extended period of time. It's very often a time when the country wants to say, wait a minute, where are we going? What direction we want to go in? And look at the polls. The polls all say Americans, about 67%, say the country's on the wrong track. So it's very important that Americans have a good sense of what those candidates want to do and to make sure they're held accountable.
As we look at this this presidential campaign, you've covered President Bush the first and the son, and you've also covered Bill Clinton. Are you surprised that the names Clinton and Bush are again talked about as potential favorites in this race?
Well, since I walked out of the White House for the last time as a reporter last September, I'm now figuring I've covered the front end of the dynasties. I'm not going to get to cover the next generations. No, I think it's only natural in our country where Roosevelt was a name that was a dynasty. Kennedy was certainly had an enduring family impact. They're not the only candidates out there, but they are candidates. Both Hillary Clinton, a senator, a secretary of state, a first lady who was very active in the country and out of the country. Jeb Bush, who's been a governor. Most of the presidents I've covered have been governors because that's executive experience. One of the reasons Scott Walker, I think, got out there early is he has an executive experience that he can put out there. And I think Americans have shown that they like that kind of executive experience.
It's tough to boil down a 40-year-plus career to a moment or two or a story or two, but I would imagine 9/11 had to be something that certainly you'll never forget.
two highlights. One was the day that was not as dramatic, 1991 Christmas Day. I had to leave my four little kids at home. They opened their presents, and in I went to the White House and reported live on the White House lawn as Mikhail Gorbachev brought down the hammer and sickle flag over the Kremlin. The Soviet Union went out of business. It was gone. And that changed our geopolitical world. The new world we got was trouble spots in isolated places. And I happened to be with President Obama, I happened to be with President Bush in Florida when he got word that of the 9/11 attacks. And maybe because I had covered the White House for at that point over 25 years, White House Chief of Staff Andy Card let me stay on Air Force One to tell the world what the president was doing, what information he was getting, and they wanted to show that the president was still in control. And President Bush kept arguing to go back to Washington. He wanted to address the nation to show that the U.S. government was not on its knees. For all the years that I've covered the White House, we've had times of danger, but never an actual attack that took 3,000 American lives in a split second.
Ann Compton, we appreciate your time. Congratulations again on a remarkable career.
It's a great pleasure to come here. I grew up on the shores of Lake Michigan, a few miles south of here in Glencoe, Illinois, and it's fun to come back.
It's good to have you back.
Thanks. You.